Welcome to another episode of The Profile. My name is Gary Dunn. We're here in the depths of ProCopy, the only place you can actually get your DVDs put onto disc and buy a trestle table at the front door and a pile of TVs. But just moving on from that, thanks to ProCopy, we're very lucky to get the opportunity once a week to interview some of Perth's more colourful musicians. And this week on the couch, or the chair, we've Mr. Dennis Broad. Dennis, thank you very much for coming in to see us.
My pleasure, young Gary.
Have you had enough food in the canteen?
No. I ate before I got here because I've heard about the food before, so I thought I'd better eat before.
Did you end up getting a massage in the massage rooms?
No, we're not doing a massage. No massage.
Do you like our little setup here with all the people we've got?
First time I've been here, and kudos to Mark. Great setup. Yep. Good vibe.
Hey, look, let's get into it. Where were you born, Dennis?
Brisbane. I'm a born and bred banana bender.
Beautiful place.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I was part of the music scene in Brisbane, for quite a long time. Well, for a fair few years before I even came to Perth.
Yep.
I came here because it was the next best offer.
Yep.
You know, I was in, I was bumming around in a few bands in Brisbane for a few years in the late 60s, early 70s. got into my first decent band because, you know, the brother-in-law of my mate Ashley, put me forward. The brother-in-law, his name was Dean, he was going to join this band with a lot of, good Perth musos, Brisbane musos. And at the last minute he pulled out, he said, but I know this young guy. And I was put forward and got the gig. And that band eventually, we worked around Perth, We worked around Brisbane for a couple of years. And in 1972, we won the Queensland final of the Hoadley's National Battle of the Sounds.
Hoadley's just keeps coming up.
Coming up.
Chocolate Mad musicians.
Yeah, absolutely. Chocolate Mad, yeah. Yeah, I won't sing the jingle, but yeah. We're all here for Hoadley's. Hoadley's Crumble, Violet
yes.
Crumble, blah, 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 blah. But yeah.
I used to like Crunchies much better, Cadbury Crunchies, but they never had a Cadbury band contest.
The Crunchy has never been able to hold nowhere near the Crumble Bar, mate.
Okay.
The Crumble Bar has always been number one.
Okay. We'll move on from that.
That's a little confectionery moment there, folks.
Would you like to give it another plug?
My shares aren't going to get any better, so okay. That's okay.
But now, when you did come to Perth, you would have been with that Damon circuit. Were you part of all of that, or was that sometime later? Or
Preston was the Brisbane band that I was just talking about. And it sort of morphed into a band with a lot of the same members, a band called Winston County.
Oh.
And we had aspirations of being on the Damon circuit.
Right.
Because we'd seen at Brisbane's Homestead Hotel, which was one of the huge, massive, wonderful 70s, hotel barns, we used to call them, they were huge rooms. And you'd have 800 people in a room on it. You know, they'd fill it every week. They had bands like Troubadours, Breakaway. I remember seeing Breakaway, at the Homestead, and many other bands, and they were all Ivan Damon touring bands from all over the country. And we, we got our stuff together. Winston County was, as a lot of the bands, we were entertainers. We were cover bands. We weren't long-haired, earring, music, get stoned, play some blues man kind of thing. We were playing all of the current stuff, unashamedly cover bands, and we did comedy.
Yeah.
We did comedy skits. We did, we did piss takes. We did all sorts of stuff like that. And that was the core, essence of the whole thing.
Yeah.
And we eventually got onto the circuit and toured for about 12 months in 74. Throughout 74, we were all over the country,
The 70s was the era of show bands, really, wasn't it?
100%.
Yeah, and that sort of started. So Troubadours, Statesmen, Brotherhood, all of those bands were very much into entertaining crowds.
Absolutely. And we...
Karma and...
We were crisscrossing the country. I mean, focusing for a minute on Ivan Damon.
Yeah.
He married a lady called Naya she was the manager of Cloudland Ballroom on a hill in Bowen Hills, Brisbane.
Right, yeah.
My parents used to go ballroom dancing at Cloudland Ballroom. You know, that's and in the early 70s, my band Preston, we were on stage in Cloudland next to the main stage where the swing band were doing all the swing groovy stuff. And to try and keep the young crowd in there or get the young crowd in, they put on Preston. And we were doing Crosby, Stills, Hollies, Beatles, all harmonies, you know, five-part harmonies and all that. And Ivan Damon was in the background. That's how we got to know about him and the circuit, blah, 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 and so forth. Damon, he was a character unto himself. He never called you mate, never called you pal, never called you by your name. It was always, you start in Perth on Friday, father. Yes, father. Yeah, everybody was, I don't know why. But God bless him. Fantastic bloke and a really good agent.
He's not with us anymore, is he?
No. He's been dead or gee, he's pushing 20 years now. Yeah. But we ended up on the circuit and we toured, you know, Winston County toured for that full year, 74. And, you know, we went to Sydney and then Melbourne and went across to
non-stop.
Adelaide. Blah, 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 all over the place. And, you know, you'd stop, you're on the road. It could be, you know, any time of the day or night. You'd stop at a roadhouse. I remember stopping at some place in the middle of nowhere and it was for food and we're on the road and it had wooden struts, girders, holding up the roof.
Yeah.
And I looked up and about probably 5 metres, 4 metres above my head on one of the crossbeams of the ceiling was a Brotherhood sticker.
Wow.
Yeah. And you think, run over! You know, and you'd be travelling in opposite directions and you'd stop and have a chat and a beer and whatever. You know, it was really a time. It really was. And we left Brisbane and did the thing in 74. The Brisbane band, Winston County, split up after doing 12 months on the road. And I was sitting in Brisbane, what am I going to do? What's the next best thing? I actually did accept an offer. I joined a bunch of serious musicians in Brisbane that wanted to have a front man, you know, mouthy kind of guy, because I'm not a mouthy kind of guy. I just do a good impression of that. And I'd actually said I'd join them, and then the offer to join Breakaway. I'd been talking to Joe Cosey. The band had disintegrated around him. He had this huge PA and a house and a wife and all sorts of stuff. And he said, come over. And it was just he and I, and we put a band together, which was Steve Ram on bass, Peter Nelson on guitar, Ray Wood on drums, and Joe on keys and me on vocals, you know. And we rehearsed it for, I don't know, a month, I think. We actually applied for the Dole at the time, I remember that. It was cool. And we went on the road. And again, the whole thing started. We were on the road with Damon. This Breakaway was a far more slick, more business orientated, far better organized setup. And we had a huge yellow bus with Breakaway emblazoned on the side of it. Yeah, five musos and two or three or four road crew, you know, an esky, double bunk and a table and chairs and a couple of tons of gear in the back, and we're on the road for 6 months of the year.
Yeah,
you know.
What a life.
I'll shut up now so you can ask me another question.
Well, I was going to ask you about Winston County, because you go to shopping centres now are remembered from Winston County and no one can remember you from Breakaway or...
I get remembered for all of it.
Yeah.
But people, I mean, just in general in life, people say, weren't you the singer of Breakaway? That happens more often.
Yeah.
But it's really amazing.
Yeah.
I think it's happened once or twice when people have said, weren't you the singer of that band? And I'm expecting Breakaway. And they say, Winston County, we're only here for 3 months from January to March in 1975.
Yeah.
That was it. And we did Pinocchio's four nights a week, I think, up to Saturday. And then we ripped the gear out and went over to do the Charles Hotel Sunday session.
Yeah.
You know, for the 3 months we were here, you know.
Wow.
Just amazing.
Yeah.
Yep.
Now, what was the turning point in your life that started you singing and wanting to perform? What was there a particular moment that you
thing that pushed me into singing was being in the school choir.
All right.
I went to Padua Boys College in Kedron. in Brisbane, and Father Odrick held auditions. And he said, right, you know, we're all boys, you know, the fellas. He said, you know, the next kid would come out and go, ding, sing that. And you go, you go over there, you know, ding. And I went, ah. So
You're over there.
That was my audition, and I was in the choir. So, you know, yeah, that was, we did Sydney of Stedfords and all that kind of stuff. Yep. Then the Beatles came along, and me and me mate Ashley, you know, would sit in, you know, over at his place. He'd play guitar. I was learning to play guitar. And we just sang Beatles songs. There was a Beatles half hour on 4BC AM radio in Brisbane every Thursday night or something, and I would not ever miss it.
Yeah.
And I knew every vocal, every harmony of pretty much every Beatles song. And it just sort of progressed from there, you know. I didn't have a moment where I said, this is what I want to do. It just evolved.
You must be doing all right, because you can hear that sound there. Was bling. They're all our viewers doing the happy faces for you, Dennis, here.
Really?
Yeah.
Technology just astounds me, Gary. It just knocks me out. Is he telling the truth?
So Beatles, obviously a big influence in your life?
Yeah, that started it off. I mean, sometimes I think people ask me what's my favourite song or favourite band or whatever. It's really hard to answer that.
Yeah.
My favourite song at the moment is Don't Act Like You Know Me, Like You Know Me, Na Na. Seriously. I mean, I just, and yet I love AC/DC.
Yes.
My favourite singer is Farnham, alongside Barnsley, a little bit behind that, and Stevie Wonder. That kind of stuff, you know. And I know that we were chatting earlier on, and I didn't even realise it at the time, but in the 70s, Peter Couples with Stylus and also a little bit of Darryl Braithwaite were also, just because it's similar kind of voices.
I haven't asked the question yet.
Yeah, I just rewound it so you can go ahead.
Okay, what Peter Couples and Darryl Braithwaite, obviously Peter Couples from Stylus, what influences they have on you?
As I say, it was indirect. It wasn't like, wow, I like that voice and I'm going to sing like that. You know, it was a similar range to me, and it suited what I liked what I was hearing when I was listening to him. And I guess that's what an influence is, you know,
So later on, or recently, you went into business with Joe Cosey, and you've... Near where I live, down in South Yundrup, you have a couple of clubs in Mandurah.
Yeah, there are only two nightclubs in Mandurah. There's Toucan Club and Players Bar, and Peter Bernard, me, and Joe Cosey went into partnership down there in 2001.
Yeah,
and it's just Joe and I now for the last 5 years, and we've been in clubs down there. You know, it's a monopoly down there, but hospitality at the moment, you know,
it's tough.
It's tough. It's tough out there.
It's a live venue, isn't it, Players?
Well, Players is a live venue. Yeah. Yes, Players has complete in-house sound system, front of house, the whole bit. So you can have bands, acts, plus DJs as well, and then there's a separate lounge upstairs, a smaller bar, which is a retro bar.
Yeah,
which. Now and then has a really talented and handsome DJ working in there, you know, every now and then. So it's a funny experience, you know, playing DJs in your own club. But it's still fun.
And that's what it's all about, isn't it? Having fun, no matter what.
If you're not having fun and if you're not laughing, you're doing something wrong.
Yeah. Mick Morecambe at Gobbles at the end used to say, "You've had your fun now." And I can't
far
say
out.
That word.
Far out. Be far out the door.
Yes.
Something like that.
Look, other jobs throughout your life. We all supplement our income somehow as musicians. Something you've done that you can tell us about?
I started at the age of 15 in the printing game, a newspaper. Folks, this is a story about compositors, not suppositories. Don't get it wrong. A hand and machine compositor was responsible for setting the type for every single word, every single line was set on a linotype machine, and was then ultimately also responsible for putting the pages of the newspaper together before they go to the press. That whole trade now doesn't exist, but that's what I started as. And that's what I went back to at the end of the 70s. I'd had enough of music for a while. And I worked at the Sunday Times as a hand and machine compositor.
Compositor.
Get it right. Yes. It's in the old hot metal, they referred to it, because every line of type was cast in molten lead. Fascinating stuff, mate.
Wow. Well, look, we've got this guitar here that we're going to give to one lucky viewer after, I think, episode 25. And here's the pen. You know where the pen is. And we got lots of really good names on here, and if you could add your signature, would be much appreciated.
Well, I'll go on the back.
You can go on the the drummers are on the back.
The drummers are on the back.
See, you're a musician. Maybe you should put it on the side. Yeah.
We'll do that because I mean, you know, people. I don't know if I can be called a muso because I'm a show off and a front man and a singer and a smart ass, not necessarily a musician. You know.
Now, what would your favourite TV show have been growing up, Dennis?
That's a hard one.
Thank you.
For only one reason. There you go.
Right, that.
Cool. Yeah. Let the ink dry.
See if we can get his signature. Yeah. Did I get that? All right.
You're not supposed to be able to read it, but who cares?
Yeah.
There were so many good TV shows. They were all half-hour sitcoms. Sitcoms is what it's not. No, I mean, actually, I tell a lie. It was, there's so many. You know, 77, Sunset Strip.
Yeah.
All that kind of stuff. There was Gilligan's Island. There was Maxwell Smart. Not now, 99. You know, there was Bewitched. You know, Hogan's Heroes. So my answer is all of those.
All of those.
Yeah, absolutely.
So your favourite TV shows. Now, what Perth band did you see live that you thought was probably the best?
That's a hard one.
Hard one?
Hard one.
Would you like to phone a friend on that one? Or?
No. Don't lock it in, Eddie. Okay. I'm not ready. Yeah, Chalice. We were talking about before.
George Heathcote was in that band, and
I didn't know his last name, but George. Yeah, lovely bloke.
The bass player. Anyway, I can't remember his name, but yeah fantastic. I seen them when they supported Queen, and they did Bohemian Rhapsody better than Queen.
Yeah, they went to the Queen concert and saw the show live.
Same.
You know, most of it was live. Yeah. And then we went to Beethoven's afterwards, and Chalice were playing.
There you go.
And I was standing in the audience. Just over there near me was Freddie Mercury with a couple of minders.
Yes.
And he was watching, and I was watching. They did Bohemian Rhapsody.
Yes. Brilliant.
Absolutely live, you know, and it was quite
I think Queen used a lot of tapes at that time during their live performances.
Yeah,
obviously Chalice didn't, so.
No.
Palace.
Yeah. No. The palette and the chalice, and it's a Danny Kaye movie.
That's it. the palace and the chalice of the malice or something.
The chalice with the palace has the brew that is true and there's something around it.
Yes.
That's it.
That's it. Yeah. We'll see if we can get that one sometime.
Stay tuned, folks. This will get better in a minute.
So what does the future hold for you, Dennis?
Not retirement. I'm not sure what the future holds as far as hospitality venues, etc. Yeah. You know, that's a little bit uncertain at the moment. But definitely... some form of entertainment. I'm comfortable being in front of an audience, having fun. I'm a good communicator. I have fun with people. I can't go to the supermarket without talking crap with a chick behind the counter. You know, I can't help myself. But yeah, so some form of entertainment part time, and maybe something, I don't know, something else, you know, just cruising through.
Yeah.
And being continuing to enjoy my two daughters, you know, who are 34 and 27, love my kids.
You have grandkids
and
as well?
And my two brand new grandkids. My
Fantastic.
Elder daughter, Alicia, a month ago,
wow,
gave birth to her second daughter.
Yep.
She's got two daughters under the age of 18 months. So, yeah.
That's a hard slog.
It's my kid, she's walking through it.
There's a place in your heart, I think, that you don't know is there. Until you feel that love of a grandchild.
And it grows on you too.
Yeah,
you know,
absolutely.
It's absolutely amazing. It takes you full circle back to when, I'm looking at Alicia.
Yes.
And I can still remember things that she said when she was a kid, and it's not that long ago, you know. Edie, my younger girl, she's just finished 5 years as a film editor for Channel 9 News.
Wow.
So proud of both my kids.
Yeah, cool. Yeah. Excellent. What unfulfilled ambitions do you have in your life? Anything that you haven't done that you want to achieve?
No, I haven't got any mountains to climb or
bucket list.
Do
you want to jump out of a plane or?
Jump out of a plane? Or, yeah, no, it's not high on my list.
And Breakaway, maybe, you know.
I couldn't, you know, just to do the things I was just saying it's about, you know, don't worry, be happy, you know, a good name for a song.
Yeah, absolutely.
And you know, have fun doing it, being in front of an audience, you know, interacting with people and enjoying life, you know.
Do you listen to some of your older music? Like I've got the Pub Legends of Perth. I think this is the first CD here. Am I getting this one right? Over there. Sorry, Mr. Strawn.
Track one isn't bad.
My Girl is just one of the greatest versions you could ever wish to hear.
Thank you. Yeah. It was fun doing it.
I haven't heard it. It's just my producer told me that.
Todd, yes. Yeah. Well, I can tell you it's...
It's good?
It's okay, you know. It gets there. It does get there. It was. We were very proud of it at the time. Still are.
Yep.
But yeah, in answer to your question, you know, I don't listen, don't sit around listening to myself on, you know, old recordings every now and then. The time that you bring that stuff out is when you've got friends and you've had a few beers and you just, you know, listen to this old stuff. That's
you can say shit on this program, it's all right.
Shit, can I? Okay.
Yes. Yeah. Right,
I'll remember that.
Now, do you collect anything? Like little soldiers or something?
Sorry, Fozzie. No.
That always stuck in my mind when I interviewed Fozzie, and the soldiers are getting smaller and... Oh, are they getting bigger?
He's wearing bigger glasses. No, kidding, he doesn't wear glasses. I remember that Foz does that. No, I'm the only thing that... And it's not even collecting. I mean, I don't know. And I've stopped doing it, but I've got a stack of old coins.
Oh, wow.
I'm not a philatelist. No, that's stamps.
Yes.
I'm not a coin collector. It's some stupid thing that I started. I've got about 4 or 5 old paper $20 Australian $20 notes. I've got 150. I don't know why. It's all still, you know, money that you can spend. But, you know.
But you're collecting it, so.
Yeah, I'm not collecting it. It's just that I did it at one stage, and it's in a bag in the drawer, and it's there, and I haven't spent it, you know. This is really dumb for me to tell you this, but yeah, that's the truth.
That's okay. We can say anything you like dumb on this show, because I'm going to ask you another dumb question.
You go right ahead.
Tell us something about yourself that nobody knows, apart from that money sort of thing.
That's about it.
Nothing at all?
Yeah.
No skeletons in the closet? No.
Sure. I mean, you know, I don't know what it is. I have an unknown 47-year-old son somewhere, you know, that was born many, many years ago before I left Brisbane. And I caught up, my very first girlfriend and I, you know, that happens at that age. And,
And you didn't know at the time, or?
Of course I did.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Oh, yeah. But who didn't know was my mother didn't know, and her father didn't know.
Wow.
That was clever. But and the interesting thing was that I was contacted by that lady, my first girlfriend, 3 years ago, and she was living in northern. She is living in northern Queensland, and she came over and we caught up.
Wow.
Yeah. You know, because we've got that bond there, but neither of us have wanted to go, both my kids, everybody in my family knows all about it, but I haven't followed up and gone to the register where you find out these kind of things, but yeah, there you go, that's my only skeleton, mate.
Okay, well, thanks for telling us that. Is there someone you'd like to nominate to come on this show? Is there someone you can think of that might enjoy this and give us an insight into their life as well?
Yeah, and it's interesting. I do know that this guy's been brought up, you know, mentioned as I just referred to Fozzie before, and we're all, you know, we've all been in bands and worked together. But good mate of mine, Steve Ram.
Oh, Steve.
Would be, because he was the bass player of that lineup of Breakaway that I came to join in 75 And he's a lovely bloke, and he's been in and around and under and over in so many different guises because he was a bass player.
Yes.
And he'll tell you, I shouldn't tell you the story, but he was a bass player. He came from down south, and he was a, you know, from a farming community, learnt to play bass, the black sheep of the family, the rest of the family are all farmers. He played bass, and he's ended up being in on stage, he's done front of house, he's done audio visual, he's done everything. He's even worked here. So.
Sheep farmer.
Sorry, I couldn't resist.
The New Zealander who was counting his sheep in the paddock, and he was going. Oh, funny.
Oh, that
maybe it's not
takes
so
me
funny.
To the top of the cliff where you do it on the top of the cliff. They put. No, I can't tell that joke. But you get the gist.
So, a bit more serious, what would you put on your gravestone?
Oh! It wouldn't be the typical other thing. It'd be like, for crying out loud, I wasn't finished.
Dennis, having fun having you here.
And, me too. And
thank you very much for coming in. I really appreciate it.
Me too, mate. It's been a lot of fun. This is really good what you guys are doing.
Thank you.
You know, I appreciate it more than you do.
We're just trying to log as many identities as we can in this colourful industry we live in. And look, I just want to remind the viewers before we go, loving your beer.
Oh, yeah.
I wish I could have one of those.
Well, you can, you know. We're finished now. The red light's still on, but you know.
I just want to remind the viewers to subscribe to our YouTube channel and give us a thumbs up. Not a thumbs down, which I think I saw last week, but I suppose we're open to criticism. And look, thank you for joining us every week. I appreciate you looking and checking out what we're doing. Thank you.
On you, Gary.
To get that one in the end.
Don't you dare cut that out.
special. It's got to be just the way.